Look at the free books I got from Stockton's Free Bookshop. Spy Thatcher by Willie Rushton and the Alan Clark Diaries. Alan Clark's Diary, Wednesday the 21st of November 1990, the day before Margaret Thatcher resigned. This is going to be politically the longest day. Not only my own prospects, but the whole edifice which we have constructed around the lady are in ruins. It's quite extraordinary. 15 years have gone by, and yet those very same people, Dykes, Charlie Morrison, Tony Grant, Barney Hayhoe, who have always hated her and the value she stood for, are still around in the lobbies, barely looking any different, grinning all over their faces. At last we've got her. I can't think of a single anti-Thatcherite who has died or receded throughout that entire period.
We'll tell her I rang, won't you?
Yes, yes, yes. Because if you tell her, she will call me. And if she doesn't call me, I'll know it's because you haven't told her. High-pitched giggle. Don't worry, I'll tell her. He won't, though. Cunt. Yet still she won't return. There is talk of a fighting statement later, but this wastage of time in Paris is sheer lunacy. Harold at Stamford Bridge. It is the general sense of disintegration now affecting everything that is so damaging to her. Unless MH is slaughtered in the final ballot, impossibly unlikely, she herself is going to find it highly difficult to reassert her authority, even if eventually she emerges as the victor. Short, that is, of giving them the full coup losers treatment, arrest, manacles, beaten up in the interrogation room, shot while trying to escape. Real blood, in other words. Fun, but a bit Angolan. Later that evening, Alan Clark managed to speak to Mrs. Thatcher. After a bit, Peter said, "I can just fit you in now, but only for a split second, mind." She looked calm, almost beautiful. "Ah, Alan, you're in a jam."
"I know that.
They're all telling you not to stand, aren't they?"
"I'm going to stand. I've issued a statement."
"That's wonderful. That's heroic. But the party will let you down."
"I am a fighter."
"Fight then, fight right to the end. A third ballot if you need to, but you lose." There was quite a little pause.
"It'd be so terrible if Michael won. He would undo everything I have fought for."
"But what a way to go. Unbeaten in 3 elections, never rejected by the people, brought down by non-entities."
"But Michael as Prime Minister."
"Who the fuck's Michael? No one, nothing. He won't last 6 months. I doubt if he'd even win the election. Your place in history is towering." Outside, people were doing that maddening trick of opening and shutting the door at shorter and shorter intervals.
"Alan, it's been so good of you to come in and see me."
Afterwards, I felt empty and cross. I had failed, but I didn't really know what I wanted, except for her still to be Prime Minister, and it wasn't going to work out. I sat on the bench immediately behind the Speaker's chair, watching the coming and going. After a bit, Tristan came and sat beside me, but he had little to say. "What is there to say? She's still seeing visitors." Then along came Edwina.
"Hello, aren't you Edwina Currie? Now then, Alan, there's no need to be objectionable. If that is who you are, I must congratulate you on the combination of loyalty and restraint that you have shown in going on television to announce your intention to vote against the Prime Minister in the leadership election.
Alan, I'm perfectly prepared to argue this through with you if you listen."
"Piss off!" Which she did.
Tristan said, "She's not a bad girl, really." At 8:30, I left to come over here. The archway exit from Speaker's Court was blocked by the PM's Jaguar. She had just taken her seat, and as the detective's door slammed, the interior light went out and the car slid away. I realised with a shock that this was, in all probability, her last night as Prime Minister. I came in with her, I go out with her, and a terrible sadness envelops me, of unfinished duties and preoccupations, of dangers and injustices remaining, of the greed, timidity, and short-sightedness of so many in public life. Alan Clark's Diaries. It's amazing what you can get for free. Alan Clark's Diaries, Thursday the 22nd of November, 1990. Very early this morning, the phone rang. It was Tristan.
"She's going."
I didn't think I could bear it, but curiosity drew me into the chamber for the lady's last performance. It would have been too macabre to have sat in my habitual place next to her PPS. So I watched and listened first from behind the chair, then from the bar of the house. She was brilliant.
humorous, self-deprecating, swift and deadly in her argument and in her riposte. Even Dennis Skinner, her oldest adversary, was feeding her lines, and at one point Michael Curtis shouted, "You could wipe the floor with a lot of them." Too bloody true. What is to become of her? Acclimatization will be agony, because she is not of that philosophic turn of mind that would welcome a spell at Column Bay. Can she just remain on the backbenches? It will be hard. What happens when she starts to be missed and the rose-tinted spectacles are found in everyone's breast pocket?